Friends, please be seated. The session is starting. Dr. Swami is presiding over the session. As I mentioned to you, this is on the government control of temple administration. And the first speaker is Prakash Rao, and the next speaker will be Prasad Yelamanchi ji. Prakash Rao ji.
Namaste. Yeah, if you don't mind, I think I have about 25-30 copies of this one. You can just place one brochure on each table so at least you all can look at it. Yeah, please. They are all up there.
Just put it on each table.
I want to thank you, Dr. Swami, for his association with us for the last 10 years, ever since we started this Global Hindu Heritage Foundation. I am from Vijayawada. So I went to United States more than 50 years ago. And we spent most of the time, retired in 2006. I came to Vijayawada. I was reading a newspaper, Yinadu. And on that paper, on August 23rd, 2006, at 7:23 minutes, this particular news item struck me so hard that I said, this is unreal. What is happening to our society? What is happening to our Bharat? What is happening to our Hinduism, our country? That news item was, Y.S. Rajasekhar Reddy issued GO21, by which he allocated crores of rupees for the construction of new churches and renovation of old churches. So after a while, so within a week or so, we found a couple of people in Hyderabad and went to the High Court and got stay order. And then realized, what is it we can do? I mean, I was so mad with everybody else because nobody was taking any interest kind of thing. I called so many organizations, nobody was paying attention to it. Then we thought, with the Prasad Yelamanchi and some, about nine of us, started this particular organization. So what is this whole temple situation is all about? Because we all have to be aware of our culture, about the status of our temples. Temples are the pillars of our organization, of our Hinduism, of our devotion, of our faith. If we lose the temples, it is going to be very difficult for the survival of Hinduism. So with that in mind, we started this Global Hindu Heritage Foundation. The temple, why is it? What is the significance of the temple? So I thought I would just spend a few minutes talking about the importance, what the temple has done for 2,000 centuries. And all of a sudden, Hindus lost control of it. Not only lost control of it, basically all the money is used by the government, all the decisions are made by the secularists. No Hindu has ever put any feedback, was allowed to even give any information to the government. They can almost appoint anybody, whether Christian, Muslim, all kinds of people, because government is secular and government is running the temples. So then as I kept going into this subject, then I realized the significance of the temple. Then this is what I found out. I read about 3-4 paragraphs, and because it is very important for all of us to know what the temples have done for our culture. Temples served as center of learning and knowledge for all age groups, foci for social gathering, facilities for art, dance and music, hubs for upholding the dharmic values, sacred place for conducting daily rituals such as archanas, somas, pujas and other samskaras, nucleus for peace, tolerance and non-violence, lighthouse for philosophy and spirituality, cornerstone for worship services, promotion of old age, time-tested universal values, institutes for yoga and meditation, holy place for conducting different festivals and rituals, and a nexus for expressing devotion through music, singing, and chanting. And the architecture of the Hindu temples are so complicated, so scientific, so philosophical, so I thought I would write up a little bit and see how it goes out. Hindu temples are architectural wonders, masterpieces, and marvels representing the diversity of cultures of our country. They are as magnificent as majestic, as beautiful as bewitching, as amazing as astonishing, as grandeur as graceful, as imaginative as intuitive, as potential as powerful, as complex as complicated, as intricate as innovative, as splendid as spectacular, as ingenious as inspirational, as mathematical as meticulous, as precise as proportional, as scientific as spiritual, and as creative as compelling. Rabindranath Tagore said, here, that is the temples, here the language of stone surpasses the language of man. So nobody can imagine the kind of majesty and magnitude of the temples if you go to Tamil Nadu and all these big places. So that is the kind of structure that we have built by so many people who have generously donated the money. Why do we want to preserve these things? What is part of this Hinduism that supports these temples? So I just wanted to give you two quotations which really hit me hard actually when I was trying to read about the significance of the temple, significance of our Hinduism, because you have to have some kind of roots or some kind of a base from which you will be able to change or able to understand and compare. In one of the Upanishads, a rishi was asking an emperor about his status of the country. The king says, in my kingdom, there is no thief, no miser, no drunkard, no man without an altar in his home, no insignificant person, no adulterer, much less an adulteress. Now, coming to 18th century, Abbey Dubois, he describes this India as follows. India has always been considered the most wealthy and opulent society, more favored by the nature than any other country in the world. A land literally flowing with milk and honey, where the sail yields all that is necessary for the existence of happy people almost without cultivation. And then he goes on to give a lot of other things. So basically, I wanted to make sure that I just give you some gist of what is. Even Lord Magani, who has created all this mess for all of us for the last close to 150, 160 years. So this is why he decided to break India and make everybody into a brown Hindu. His assessment of Hinduism at that particular time. I have traveled across the length and breadth of India, and I have not seen one person who is a beggar, who is a thief. Such wealth I have seen in this country, such high morals, people of such caliber, that I do not think we would ever conquer this country unless we break the very backbone of this nation, which is our spiritual and cultural heritage, and therefore I propose that we replace our old ancient educational system for our culture. For if Indians think that all that is foreign and English is good, greater than their own, they will lose their self-esteem, their native culture, and they will become what we want them, a truly dominant nation. So he accomplished it. Only one man. So we have how many grads here? How many grads Swamiji's, Swami Dr. Swami is going to create. So all of us can take a stand and take a vote to make sure that we preserve our culture, stand for our nation, make sure our Bharat would remain a Hindu Rashtra or Hindu nation, because all the other religions have, Muslims have 56 countries, Christians have any number. Where do we have a Hindu nation? If I want to go to a nation where I feel comfortable, where do I go? Do I have a Hindu nation? No. Why don't we just stand up and say this is a Hindu nation, that we need to establish Hindu Rashtra? I think that is the best way we can preserve this culture. Otherwise, with all the things that are going on in West Bengal, Assam, Kashmir, Kerala, and Telangana, space is shrinking for the Hindus. And we have to fight for it. This is a survival. So let us make sure we will try to do the best we can to preserve our culture. And let us not be discouraged, because every one of us can do something. There is a quotation which I really like. This one is, I am only one, but still I am one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do something that I can do. So that means all of us can do something. And just one more quotation before I go into our discussion on the temples. In Ramayana, you will see this particular quotation about fulfilling our responsibility. Because all of us have responsibility to preserve our culture, protect our temple, maintain it, promote it. It is our responsibility, each one of us, that is our dharma. And in Ramayana, it says, if we don't take the responsibility, what will happen? The ignoble would resemble the noble. And he who is devoid of honor would resemble a man of integrity. He who is unworthy would be deemed worthy. And he who is deproved would be considered to be a man of virtue. So that means we are making all the criminals, the noble people, all kinds of cheats, so run around free. So it is our responsibility to make sure that we try to protect our culture. Now coming to this particular act, and as I mentioned, we started way back in 2006, and that was the time we met Dr. Swami. He has guided us. The first question was, Dr. Swami, why don't we go to Supreme Court and make sure that we file a case on the basis of the discrimination, because churches are not under control, not under government control, mosques are not under government control, so why don't we go and file? He said, that's not the way it works. You have to prove that the government is cheating and destroying and doing some mischief, and then you have to have a lot of evidence, a proof, data. Only then you can go to Supreme Court and then file the case. Till that time, there is no chance any Supreme Court will even bring that one up. So this is the brochure, and I'm going to send you email to Jagdish Bhai, because I didn't bring enough of them. He will send this so you can look at it. And what we did, we tried to collect all the information from different states, what has happened in all the states. If you look at Maharashtra, Shirdi Sai Baba temple and Siddhivinayaka temple, they have taken over by the government. Basically, nobody can account for the money. They can use it whatever way. There are a lot of mismanagement and abuse. And then they used to even have roads split to the trustee's acreage, so that his trustee land price will be valued higher than others. So all kinds of things have been done. In Rajasthan, of course, Chamundi temple. And in Bihar also, Orissa, And in Andhra Pradesh, there I can just give you a lot of information about what is happening. And 2000, almost five hills of TTD. Rajshekhar Reddy was planning to take over and then convert them into state property and then give it to the Christians and whatnot. A lot of other things there have been done. And government allocated almost 6.5 crores or more to the mosques every year. I feel so sad and mad actually when I go to Hyderabad or Delhi to see Hajj terminal. And here we have so many millions of people going to Sabarimalai, sleeping like dogs on the streets. This is not my word. One of the ministers said that one. We have people sleeping like dogs on the street, whereas here you have special Hajj terminal just for a handful of them. And then all the ministers keep talking about, and Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, they said they are going to have Christian powers. So this is the kind of tendency. So we are not fighting for it. We are not aware of what is happening. Now we have to make sure that we know everything and everybody what they are doing it, and we have to fight for it. So once we realized this one, I think with so much help, we realized not even 1 or 2% of the people know what is happening to the temples. They are under the government control, they are manipulating, they are doing. So as a result, we wanted to make sure how to make people aware of it. So we conducted two Padayatras, going from village to village, 1 year from Basra to Tirupati and another year from Sri Kurman to Tirupati. Just on the way, keep talking about the significance of the temple, why they should come to the temple, why they should do the arti, singing, bhajans. This is a particular number of things. And later on, we produced a CD, which is called Devalayam. Just in Telugu, we also have now in Hindi, you can download these songs actually from our website, savetemples.org. Only to make people aware of the significance and importance of the temple. Why do we have to go to the temple? What is it? Is there a significance? What is Rajgopal? What is Varsama? Why do we have to circumvent? Why do we have to do puja? Why do we have to do Ajna? All those things are addressed in these songs. Now, over a period of time, so we also went to a number of, like we mentioned a number of times, we went to court also. And then we opened an office in Hyderabad also about 4 years ago to make sure whenever we have some issue, we have a staff who will try to go to the court, if we have to go to the minister's office and all that. And in about 2012, we have actually invited the endowment minister to United States, because whenever you come and talk to any minister here, within 5 minutes, there will be 10 people barging in and then he won't even let you complete one sentence. So finally we convinced and took him eight hours. We had a seminar. We actually submitted 100 recommendations. It was mind-boggling for him. He said, the only thing I can do based on your intensity and passion, I will make sure no land will be sold, because that was the one. In 1 year, Rajshekhar Reddy sold 20% of the temple lands in 2007 and 2008. So they brought that law now. It is being enforced. If at all they have to sell for whatever reason, they can only lease it. They can't sell it. If they have to sell it, they have to go to the High Court to make sure the High Court is satisfied with the reasons, and then temple and other people also can go under defending the High Court. So that is an improvement. Now, I think for the last 2 years, definitely there is a lot of improvement, but you can't be just happy with what is happening, because the endowment ministry of Andhra Pradesh at this time is RSS background, so he is very much interested in trying to preserve and protect and all that. But later on, some other guy might come and then we might change the whole thing. So we have to be very cautious and then make sure that we still keep fighting. And of course, Tamil Nadu, I think Ramesh, if he had come, probably he has given more information, because they have collected information from about 2,500 temples of all the mismanagement, and then submitted to Dr. Dhanan Saraswati. So he filed a case. Dr. Swami agreed to defend that case, and so I think we need to applaud Dr. Swami for agreeing to defend this case, actually, the temple management. And, you know, we always invited Dr. Swami to the United States at least about 6-7 times. We have organized a number of seminars all across the United States. Last time in August, so in Chicago, 5 lectures. In Dallas, we had 5 lectures, so morning and evening. See, he didn't have rest, actually, when he came to the United States. So now, you know, this October 10th, so we had a seminar, actually, in Visakhapatnam also. At that time, Dr. Swami said, Prakash Rao, you stop talking about this Endowment Act, repeal of Endowment Act, forget about it, so I will take care of it. Now you start talking about how to manage the Hindu temples by Hindus. So we are planning to have a brainstorming session on 9th of this month, and then we are going to have one in the United States, and then keep collecting all the information. So that way, when the Supreme Court makes a decision, at least we are mentally prepared, and physically, maybe we will appoint a committee with the help of Dr. Swami before that to see some draft of the manual can be prepared, so that with less time, the temples can be slowly given back to the Hindus. So, and so Dr. Swami is the one who is instrumental. I think I wanted to repeat it, because if we didn't have his guidance and his support, you know, just the name itself carries so much strength and so much trust and so much confidence. Anytime, whenever we are frustrated or whenever we know, just call Dr. Swami, it's over, so you don't worry about it, because he is like a mountain. You have Himalayan mountain, you know, stable, so strong. So I don't think there is anybody who is as strong, as powerful, as committed to Hindutva, because politics is not going to influence him. His conviction, his faith, his passion for Hinduism is the one that is going to be the hallmark of Dr. Swami, who is basically, we all call, a single army, you know, person kind of thing. So let us just make sure that he will provide the guidance all the way through. I mean, I can give you so many examples, but basically, I think because of the time we have been. So just this one, people have a look at. I will send it to Jagdish. Please pass it on to all the people, so that way, if you have any questions or anything, please let us know. We will communicate and we will respond. So, and with that, I thank you all so much, Dr. Swami, for all the guidance and everything that he has been giving it to the country, not just only temple issue, wide range of, I don't know, anybody has done the variety of the cases that he has taken and won. Not a single soul on planet Earth. We salute him. Thank you, Dr. Swami.
Now, Mr. Prasad Yelamanchi will express his views.
One word before Prasad Yelamanchi makes his submission. Prakash Rao has been very kind in referring to my work, but one of his work, which I couldn't believe it till I saw it, was the Hanuman temple that he has built in Dallas. I think future temples in India should be built on the same architectural plan. He raised the money himself. I don't know how he managed it. And in fact, while I was there, there was a gentleman who had come from Singapore, and he took out his checkbook and wrote $3 million. Well, I mean, that shows his power to attract people. So he has done tremendous work for temples in the United States. And then now he's working here. So, and I have stayed in his house. He's a great host. And any of you ever visit the United States, please go to Dallas. And that temple is worth seeing. I mean, how it is being designed and how it's being maintained. Okay, we get Prasad.
Dr. Swami, honorable delegates. Yes, Dr. Swami, I heard that Hanuman Temple, Prakash Rao Prasad, is a work of art. It is a great temple, and I request all of you, if you visit the United States, you must visit Hanuman Temple in Dallas. You see, when I was a kid, I used to admire many national leaders, and one of them was Mahatma Gandhi. My brother was named after Mahatma Gandhi. My father named him Gandhi. But as I grew up, before this last election, last 10 years, I was really, really disgusted, depressed, you know. There's no leader that I could be proud of until Dr. Swami, I came into his contact. I would not hesitate, I adore Dr. Swami. If I were a younger man, if I have children, I would definitely name after Dr. Swami myself. Many times Dr. Swami came to United States inspired, you know. And many times I compared him with Socrates. But he did one step higher than Socrates. Socrates only wrote philosophy, you know, great values, moral values. Dr. Swami not only moral values, he practices. He shows us the way, you know, to adopt those great values, you know. I thank Dr. Swami. Give him a big hand for Dr. Swami. From the day one we started this temple movement, Prakash Rao and I, since 2006, Dr. Swami was there for us. We did two protests, and then when we went to see Dr. Rajasekhar Reddy, he was there, you know. And as a result of all his efforts, Dr. Rajasekhar Reddy, one day he decided to release 30,000 temples. And Dr. Swami was following up. Yeah, he's going to send an EO, executive order next week, next month, like that. Kept on going and going, and I think in the meantime, Sonia Gandhi called, you know, and said, don't do it. And then afterwards he died, you know. And see the power of we gave up our freedom. A foreigner comes, she can dictate, you know, what can be done here. Two times they were having a sadhu sadasu. We just, Prakash Rao and I attended on the second. Sonia Gandhi called and canceled twice. And she, what an influence, tremendous influence on the whole nation she had. She's only a foreigner. Yeah. And so we gave up our freedom, you know, by having temples under government control. I attended a conference, HMEC, Hindu Mandir Executive Conference in Trinidad last month, they passed a resolution. I'd like to read that one here. It is hereby resolved that HMEC appeals to the governments of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana to give Hindu temples and other Hindu religious institutions the same privileges that are accorded to churches and mosques. It is hereby requested to abolish the Hindu Religious and Charitable Endowment Act entrusting the Hindu to manage their temples. Please stop diverting and selling temple resources and properties to general funds or other charities. Please stop discriminating and interfering in Hindu organizations and accord the same privileges enjoyed by Muslim and Christian organizations and institutions. What a pity. Yeah. 800, this HMEC, Hindu Mandir Executive Conference, is a baby of BHP. And this last conference they had in Trinidad, and they passed this resolution to control, to release the temples. I mean, it's a Hindu majority nation, and we have to request, oh, please, give us temples back. And it's a very sad situation. Anyway. Ladies and gentlemen, today we have historic opportunity to do right what was done wrong for Hindu Samaj for over 1,000 years. You know, when Mahmud Ghazni invaded India and he looted Somnath temple, what Hindus did? Oh, they rebuilt again. They put more gold into the temple. Instead, they should have built an army and to protect the borders of India. They built again, they built this temple, again he looted. What happened? 17 times he looted. We put all our wealth into temples, and so somebody can loot. The same thing can happen now, today. Now they're not foreigners, but they're our own people. Look, anybody, you must have read in the newspapers, there's 5.5 tons of gold they're going to, give to government, so they can borrow money against it, for to develop. And I don't know if the government going to give back. I think I heard M.T. Ramara also took some money, borrowed money. I don't know if he paid yet. So we are giving up our freedom. Whereas Christians and Muslims, they're free. All the money they give to their religion, it is spent only for the religious purposes. Whereas Hindus, the money they give to the God for the sake of, for Hindu causes, that is meant for secular purposes. When Rajasekhar Reddy was in power, they used money, temple money for a golf course for Rajasekhar dad's birthday or something. They used money to fix sewer system in Tirupati. They used money to build bus shelters. So that's great. You're already paying taxes anyway. Why are you spending your money for this? Whereas they can, other religions, they can spend their money, advocating their religion, or proselytizing, or poaching on Hindus. And here we Hindus meekly spend money for secular purposes. So think about it. United States Constitution is the most profound document ever created by man in the man's modern era to advance humanity. More than 40% of the world population adopts its ideals. Today, we want to create an equally great document, if not better than United States Constitution, to advance the cause of Hindu community. Also, to Gurudev's cause of Hindu community also, and the result of make this planet Earth a better place to live for all mankind. It should not only be a great document, it should also be as good as Bhagavad Gita. But an everlasting one, Bhagavad Gita narrated by Sri Krishna over 5,000 years ago, is still as relevant as it is today. So this document must last as long as Bhagavad Gita. That is the goal. Why we came up with, when Dr. Swami came to United States, he came to Chicago, we had two conferences, Hindu Unity Conference, and then we had Hindu-Jewish Conference. And Dr. Swami was just saying, and Israel was so impressed by that one. And they, you know, he only spoke 15 minutes, and they gave standing ovation. They were so impressed, Jews, you know, first time it happened there in Chicago. So I requested Dr. Swami there. So about this, again, temple issue brought it up. We asked Dr. Swami to lead this movement and lobby and get this law passed. I think this is going to be his legacy. If it doesn't happen, I think we should do as a protest as big as Salt March or United States Civil Rights Movement, because this is, this morning we were discussing, it's a moral issue, is it not? Why Hindu temples have to be governed by the government? I mean, this is a secular constitution, right? That means government is not supposed to have any interference in the temples. Just recently, they announced with BJP government, there are 15 areas they were giving FDI. One of them is media. You believe it? One of them is media, free speech. We are giving away for the foreigners. And yet, they try to control the temples, curtailing your free speech. Well, after doing a lot of research, Dr. Swami said in Chicago, okay, now it is, temples are going to be, is also the court, Supreme Court, about Chidambaram temple. And it is going to happen. Government is going to get out of the temples. But who do you give it to, these temples? That is the big question. So he gave us a tall assignment. We need to define who gets to manage the temples, who gets to vote these temples, and we have to figure out, write this constitution that Dr. Swami is going to forward, I hope, to make in Kerala. Well, after doing a lot of research for the last several years, I came to the conclusion the document created by Sri Lakshmi Narayan Ji, who was secretary of VHP, who is deceased now, was the closest thing to base upon why reinvent the wheel. So I figured to base on that one, and then we add things or delete things. But the Dharmic Council Constitution Convention must work out, debate, and other details. Now its objective should be to entrust the administration of temples, mutts, teerthas, and other Hindu institutions to an integrated and legitimate body of the Hindu society called Dharmic Council, and to enable the followers and devotees to develop them in accordance with their Dharma Shastras, their genius and requirements. A harmonious blending of the sanction of Dharma and the sanction of Raja are visualized under this concept of the and system. But with this plan, the concept of Dharmic Council to administer Hindu religious institutions, okay, you cannot see very well, but starts at state level, both based statutory Dharmic Council. Then under that, shortlisted executive of the Dharmic Council. Then there are going to be commissioners, and then commissioned with regional officers and regional advisory committees. There will also be temple and voluntary devotee associations, mutt and voluntary devotee associations, religious and congregation and voluntary devotee association, charitable institutions of Hindu Dharma. Under this system of Dharmic Council, a statutory body of apex level and voluntary bodies at ground level, ensuring social participation, religious authority and efficient administration are visualized. In between accommodating and utilization of all the religious and Hindu social manpower is also visualized through the various advisory committees and functional committees. So what kind of rules are we going to develop? To vote, to elect and to administer temples, to advance Hindu cause to the maximum benefit of Hindu community. Of course, we would like to follow democracy, but not necessarily. We need to look out to the West. We have great examples from our very own history, that is Uttar Meru inscriptions during Chola Empire in the 10th century. Mr. S.C. Bradley and others have done good research to be able to adopt good ideas into our constitution, into the temple constitution. Some examples are qualifications to be elected to as a trustee or to vote and all that stuff. One is to be elected as a trustee, you must own more than a quarter mile of tax-paying land. Does not mean we have to exactly adopt, but these are ideas to adopt, you know. He must live in a house built in his own land. His age must be between 35 and 70. Only those who are conversant to be taken and virtuous shall be taken this one. Those who possess honest earnings, whose mind is pure, who has not been on any committees for the last 3 years. Now, rules for disqualification. One who has been on the committee but has not submitted accounts last 7 years. Anyway, these are some examples that can adopt from our history. And during Chola time, they had great democracy system of administering institutions. At the convention, constitutional convention for the Dharmic Council, we need to discuss who is eligible to vote, who is eligible to run for office, what are the rules to disqualify, what will be the issues and causes that temples will take up to advance the cause of Hinduism. How can this organization help Hindus in other countries? Example, now there are 20,000 Hindus in Peru. These are not Indians, they are Peruvians. And they adopted Hinduism by conviction, not because somebody proselytized, forced them. There are many, many issues to discuss. How do we counter aggressiveness of other religions poaching on Hindus? Since we are in a competitive world of organized Abrahamic religions, in order to survive, we must get organized. That's the only way to do it, not by keeping temples independent, but keeping them under one trust. And we will have power then. We'll have all the money into it. For example, my friend of mine, he wants to make a movie of ancient history of Hindu kingdoms. In Delhi, every time he comes to visit Delhi, he feels very sad. He feels very sad because our old fort is more and more, little bit more destroyed. All the Bangladeshi Muslims come, I understand they occupy, you know. Wherever their temple next to it, they just cook meat and smoke going there and all the stuff. In fact, one time he was visiting and so at that time, he was director of archaeology, you know, and he was making a film on Prithviraj. And so he showed him and he asked him to come for coffee and had coffee. And he was digging somewhere and he thinks he found, what is the name of that, Pandavas lived, the house. Indraprastha, I'm sorry. Indraprastha. He thinks he is Indraprastha. He dug it down and he thinks he found Indraprastha. But he had a Muslim employee on it and he reported to, he's doing it with his own money. He reported to the Minister of Culture and who he reports. And the minister said, stop it. So he put the dirt back and closed it down. So this, my friend, he wants to make all about all the ancient Hindu kingdoms. But he went halfway through and now he ran out of money, he started. But he wanted to make otherwise 10 films and he had a deal with a Hollywood agent. So they will show on a national TV, you know, Discovery Channel or one of these national channels or BBC, something like that. Suppose we had this trust, we had money, like, you know, TTD money plus all the other temples' money, people would, for causes like this, people would give money, they would have money to do research on Hinduism, make films on our ancient history, and all this stuff that is not being done. Rather, Baptist Dr. Swami fighting. We have our own temples we are managing. We'll have all the money for Dr. Swami to fight all these battles he's doing there. You know. So, which means we can have this this under one trust. We can do wonders. Take, for example, Seventh-day Adventists. They are playing havoc here in India. One day they converted 40,000 people in their Lord. In one day. Of course, maybe they were gathering all these people and they converted. And they have built institutions in California, world-class university, Loma Linda University, and they built a hospital. World-class hospital that cures cancer. They send their doctors to 100 countries from the graduates. So that's how they're spending their money. How Hindus are we spending? We gathering, collecting gold, then we are lending to the government. Otherwise we'll build more bricks and mortar temples, but we should be building in people's mind. You know, we are not educating our people enough. You know, in Hinduism, that is why they don't have strong conviction. They can convert all of us here, but they can convert people who don't have strong conviction. So we need to build great institutions. You know, that, I mean, there is no research done on Hinduism. I went to Maharishi Mahesh University in Iowa. It's all Americans. There are white people managing. They're doing research on Ramayana, Mahabharata, you know, they're doing research on yoga, meditation. They are doing it. You know, we should be doing that with Hindu money. We should be doing all those things. So not. And also, I want to think this, we had conference at TTD, Prakash Rao and I attended on the 2nd. They invited all the Swamijis and some activists, and they're concerned about the conversion. And they're playing havoc. I would like to say, this is a winnable war. We can reconvert all those, we should be doing that. They have a right to convert us, we have a right to convert them back. You know. And we should be doing that. If we have this, you know, power instead of temples independently managed, we have these instead of government, we have under this committed Hindus. They are managed. we can win back all the Hindus that left. We'll bring them back. And let's see what's happening to Christianity. Recently, when I was at in California, I went to a conference they had. They found out Pew, if you heard of Pew Research, they always take surveys about so many different things. So they took survey, they found out since from 2007 to 2014, Christians, those who said they're Christian in 2007, they dropped by 8%, more than 1% a year. 8% they lost, Christians. And they increased in the United States, I think, 1 or 2% Hindus and Muslims. I think this is due to migration. Hindus and Muslims numbers went up. So they do not have good argument, they do not have good ideology, or they do not have good philosophy. It's all based on you believe in Muhammad or you believe in Jesus, that's it. Don't ask any questions, you cannot question. Hinduism is the great thing about Adi Shankara had debates, Adi Shankara debates. You can always question, you can always challenge our rules. And we are not set in stone Middle Ages. We can challenge. That's how we can challenge. And now there is a movement in the United States that people are questioning their religion. That's why they're not getting satisfactory answers. When I went to this Trinidad conference, there were some Americans were there. And one of them, he was from Detroit, and he said, why did you take up Hinduism? You should be happy with your Christianity, you know? He said he was raised as a Catholic and he was 18. He was questioning. He did not get the answers from his priest. Then he asked another priest when he was 25 and went on and on higher up. He did not get answers. When he saw Paramahamsa, Yogananda Paramahamsa, he got some answers. And when he was 35, he converted into Hinduism. He took Nishtha. Now he is appointed as Pracharak for Hindu American Foundation. Hindu American Foundation is the second generation Indians, and they are fighting, they are a lobbying group and they are an advocacy group in the United States. So they are appointed a white man. There were so many, also many Americans are taking Hindu values, but they are not calling themselves Hindus. Now it is popular, it is fashionable to practice yoga and meditation. Fashionable to be a vegetarian, and it's fashionable to practice the animal rights, and environmentalism is fashionable. They're all Hindu values, right? But do not call themselves Hindus. This is where Hinduism, our Hindu leadership, can step in, make them Hindus. There are 20 million Americans practice yoga and meditation, and so many more millions in Europe and Brazil. And in Brazil, there is a one high school, it is required compulsory yoga meditation they have to take. If you go to Iowa, this town, and at 5 o'clock, this is a small town. There's no traffic jams here. But at 5 o'clock, they have a traffic jam because they're all going to go yoga lessons and meditation lessons. So this is the venerable one. I think we can do this. We work together, and we should work. All the Hindu organizations must work together. I think I appeal to Dr. Swami. We will make this great constitution that will last 1,000 years, and you take it over from there.
Before Swami gives his remarks, Govindari wanted to add something for a minute.
Yes, sure.
Namaskar. I have been working on this temple's management and takeover and all for more than 2 decades under the able stewardship of Pooja Swami Dayananda Saraswati under Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha, which Dr. Swami knows well. I made some observations on the earlier speakers. Mutts cannot be taken over under the council because Mutts themselves have their own constitution, and in many parts of South India, I am not aware of North India, Mutts run temples correctly. There is no need for us to think on that. It will create a focus. Secondly, there are different types of following. Dvaita, Advaita, Vishishta Advaita, Pancharatram and all. So it is not possible for us to give them a common council code as to how to conduct the rituals and other things. Thirdly, Hindu will get hurt if you interfere with the religious matters of the temples. So we can only administer the non-religious part. I don't want to use the word secular part, the administrative part of it, for which we can make an effort so that all the leakages can be stopped and things can be improved upon. Lastly, it is not possible for us to produce a film or do something as we want because, as per Chidambaram's constitution, it's already there, sir. The culvert, the epigraphy is already there. How to run a temple has been decided by our great-great-grandfathers, and the epigraphy is available, printed format is available in Chidambaram temple. So we need not invent the wheel, the whole thing is already there. We published it under Ashwavidya Gurukulam few years ago, and it was found by many of the states acceptable, especially Karnataka, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, because during the time when I was in the Dharmic Parishad of state for Mutt Mandir Vivad, and also in Tirupati as a Dharmic Parishad member, we brought in all those things which have been certified, validated by no other person than Nadiche Devudu, Nadamadam Devam, Shankaram, Chandrasekhar Saraswati. He has said that he is one of the best models which Hindus can follow while administering the temples. So, while creating awareness amongst Hindus to run their own temples, a big question will come. If you bring a constituted body and have elections, then it will again get politicalized. What? See, we are all talking of Tirupati, Kalahasti and few other temples, or Shirdi Sai temple. There are more than few lakh temples where there is no Dupadipa Nevedim also. Hindus have to come forward to take up those things, sir. Show an example, then talk of Tirupati and all that. Chidambaram is a different case. Like that recently, Kashi has gone out of our hands. We have to take up that. Those specific cases we can fight and take back. I don't say that Hindus are not capable of handling the temples. Few years ago, Hindus were who were managing the temples. In Karnataka, temples are managed by many mutts in the most appropriate way. So, Dharmastara is one example. So, we can follow certain models, and then bringing in all the temples under one council will again become such a powerful body, then there will be a lot of politicalization, corruption and all that. So, yeah, very deep insight, following the traditional way of handling the temple, of religious and non-religious matters as we have in Tirupati, and not allowing the government to enter into it should be our first agenda. And if you touch any of those big temples where there is a lot of money, our own Hindus will start talking that we are going to take over those temples because there is a lot of money. We need to think of small temples. We call it in Andhra, we have Bodurai, we have small Mariamman temples, village temples, Kuladevam temples, all those things you take over, yeah, Gramadeva, then slowly a movement can be created for which we have to source funds, our own funds, Hindus have to contribute, and then set an example and do it. I was with the Chief Secretary and Principal Secretary of Revenue last week. They were asking us to take small temples where the locals are not able to manage, so we can support them and see that some of the rituals are celebrated, and slowly a movement can be created. So this is a very tricky subject, and moreover, sir, the donations given to the deity as per the Endowments Act belongs to the deity. You cannot sell his land, it belongs to the deity. And if an endowment is given for a specific purpose of annadanam and all, we can do. Recently, sir, Tirupati is planning to buy gold bonds. There we can go against them. Because the gold endowed to Lord Venkateshwara is for his abharana. If it is used for any other purpose, then the court will accept and the people will also accept. You cannot lay roads and drainage unless it is endowed for that purpose. So some of these tricky things have to be kept in mind before we launch something like this. And then I am sure with the huge wisdom and experience of Dr. Swami, a guideline can be created keeping Chidambaram constitution in mind, and we can do something. Thank you very much.
So this is for conclusion, right?
Yes.
Well, you know, it's a great pleasure to listen to both Prakash Rao and Prasad Yelamanchi, because they have been successful in other areas, secular areas, let's say, and they've done extremely well in their careers, but they gave it all up for this cause, and they've been dedicated for it and produced results. I have only 4 or 5 comments to make. Because after this is the round temple session, or
round temple, no, Varna and then Ram.
Ah, yes, Varna and then Ram. Now, first of all, a temple is a very special thing in Hindu religion, and not all temples are equal. A temple is a temple in our Hindu tradition if it is constructed according to Agama Shastras and Prana Pratishtha Puja. You have temples on the road, you have temples here and all. I don't know whether they follow any of that. In fact, they probably don't, and therefore they are really sometimes money-making exercises by people who just capture a certain amount of property. But if a temple is properly according to Hindu Shastras, it means that Lord, the deity, has entered the murti there and becomes the owner. After that, nobody can be the owner of that temple. The owner of the temple would be the Lord, the deity. And we can best be trustees of that temple for its management. Now, this was tested when I was law minister in 1991. When a Nataraj statue was taken away by smugglers and put up for auction in London. And the argument given by the auctioneers is that this Nataraja was from a disused temple. And they had paid some money to a farmer who had found it and had kept it in his house. So it became their property. This is their argument. And so our government then, at my monitoring, argued that since that temple was formed with Prana Pratishtha Puja, therefore the Lord had entered it. And it doesn't matter whether there is puja or there is not a puja. It is always a temple. Nobody can, even if you demolish it, it is still a temple and can be rebuilt on that very spot. That argument was surprisingly accepted by the House of Lords, which is the equivalent of their Supreme Court, and they returned the Nataraja temple back to India because of this principle. And this same argument was used in the Ram temple case in Allahabad High Court, and the Allahabad High Court judgment says precisely that the dome and the area below it belongs to Lord Rama, and therefore it will be returned to Lord Rama and a temple will be built there. The only part of the judgment which was that somebody added one of, and that was not a Muslim judge who added, there was one Muslim judge and 2 Hindu judges. One Hindu judge also said, why not build also a masjid by the site? That we don't accept, and that's why the matter is in the Supreme Court. Therefore be very clear, a temple belongs to the Lord, and it can, once built according to the Shastras, nobody can demolish it. And if they do demolish it, it can be rebuilt, your rights will be intact because you are the trustee of the Lord. Second thing is that there is a lot of complaint that the law only provides for taking over Hindu temples. What about masjids? What about churches and so on? This matter had gone before the Supreme Court saying that why this discrimination? And the Supreme Court said, we never stopped you or the government from taking over masjids and churches. No case has come to us where the question has arisen that this is the all the mismanagement that is going on in the church or in the masjid, and therefore the government should take over, but government is not taking over. No one has brought a single case. And I have, for the last 20 years, been demanding from anybody who can give me some documentation of any masjid or any church where there is a financial management, mismanagement going on, and I assure you I'll go to the court and get it to be taken over. But I'm not getting it. Because there they maintain great secrecy. Probably the Hindu temple is so open. Anybody can see what is going on. And therefore, and second, as it's been correctly pointed out, you cannot take over the temple. You can only take over the financial management of the temple. The administration concern connected with the financial management of the temple. And what happened in when Mr. Karunanidhi, lifelong ambition to grab Chidambaram temple. No, really, I mean, this is it's called Chidambaram temple because of the town of Chidambaram, not because of that idiot. In the town of Chidambaram stands a very ancient Shiva temple. Sometimes called Nataraja temple because that's where the Tandav pose of Nataraja can be seen. And the Pujaris are called Dikshitas. They originally came from Sultanpur in UP. And they were all part of the Shiva Parivar. In fact, they say one of the Dikshitas is also Lord Shiva. I mean, that's a very, very ancient temple, and Karunanidhi had said that the Dravidian movement will never be complete till we take over this temple. They tried and tried and tried, and finally in 2006, they took it over. Then the Dukshitas, poor people, went to the High Court, lost their single bench, went to the division bench, lost their. And then they couldn't go to the Supreme Court because they had no money. And they didn't know Delhi. So I got a call from Swami Dayanand Saraswati that I should take it. He said, how can I take it? They have already lost in two levels. Wow, how will I go? With what face I will go? He says, I'm giving Ashirvadam. Your Ashirvadam, you go, you'll win. I said, Swami, it will never work. That'll be laughed out of court. You go, you take my word and go. I said, if you say like that, I will go. So I went and filed an SLP, and it came before a Muslim judge and a Christian, hardline Christian judge, Joseph Sinhack. I told Swamiji that morning, no, there's no hope now, because you know, these two will never agree. He said, no, you go, you see what happens. And I went up here, and Justice Kabir, it was, he asked me, who are you? I mean, who are you in the means that what is your locus in coming here? It's not that rude word that you are nobody, who are you? Sometimes people in the newspapers read it and get misunderstanding. So I said, I am the legal counsel of the Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha, and I am a Hindu. And I am aggrieved by this takeover. Are you going to be surprised? He says, okay, you can have your petition to them. So, that answer your work. So then I argued, and finally the judgment given has now given you potentially the the right to take away all the temples from government hands. What the government says is that no temple shall be taken over unless it is proved beyond reasonable doubt that there has been financial management. So far, that was never required. All that to do is the government had to say there is financial management, whether there was or not. In fact, the Chidambaram temple is one of the best managed temples, but they just took it over. And the High Court supported Karunanidhi on that. But they laid down, you have to prove. That means you have to first establish, after hearing both sides, that there is financial management, number one. Number two, you can take over only for a limited period. I suggested 3 years, the court said it could be 5 or 3. So a limited period, and during that period you clean up the administration, the financial management, and return it back to the trustee. So 3 to 5 years. Third is that if the takeover notice does not mention the time period for which you are taking it over, then ipso facto that takeover order is null and void. So now, Tirupati was taken over in 1933. How many years now? 83 years. All these things happened during the British period. Most of the temples are there. Now, tomorrow I go and file a case in the, an application to the Andhra Pradesh government, now Telangana government, saying that please take away your executive officer, because he has been there more than 3 to 5 years. But who do I give it to? Somebody says some Hathiram trust is there or something.
Hathiram.
But other sadhus say, no, you can't give it to him.
No.
They have no connection now.
No.
I know that. So, these are, so therefore I am saying that there is no one body which should demonstrate, one body which should decide how to run these temples. These temples temporarily should be taken over by somebody and then given back to some trustees or create a new trust and do it. The principle that you can take over a temple can only be when you take it over for financial management. And I tested this out when in Tirupati, the government appointed trustee and Mukesh Ambani decided to gold plate the Tirupati temple completely, make it into a golden temple.
Swarnamayam.
Huh? Swarnamayam. And they were going to bore holes in the wall and put the gold in a, hammered into a wooden frame and then push it against the wall. Now the wall had all kinds of shlokas on how Naivedyam, how can you do prasad, everything was written there. And it would all get covered up, plus get damaged. So I went, I talked to the trustees and said, what is this you are doing? And you are going to cover up everything that is there on the wall. He said, no, we have taken video and we are going to put the CDs in the museum and people can see there. He said, then also do the archana also on video and put it there so that nobody needs to go to Tirupati anymore. So I went to High Court of Andhra and won the case. And that was done there. And poor trustee, his heart was so much in it that later on he died.
Adhikeshwaru.
And you know, he was appointed as chief trustee. And his main claim to fame is that he always sold illegal liquor. Right? He's a liquor man. So, therefore, but Lord Tirupati, you see, he never fails to take revenge. That, the Chief Minister, Vaisekar, Rajshekar Reddy, he also tried funny tricks and one day, boom, out. So today, the law is this. Finally, there was a comment about, so I must tell you that the Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha is now meeting in Goa on February 19th. and I've been invited to come and speak on this issue. All Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha consists for the first time in our Hindu history as a body which Govind Hari has been involved for a long time. In fact, one Sammelan he did here in Hyderabad, which is most magnificent in marriage. The Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha consists of all Shankaracharyas, all Mahamandaleshwars, all Akhadas, all the various types of religious leaders. They come together. This is a great, great invention of Swami Dayananda Saraswati. And that's meeting in February, and we will make out the rules and hopefully bring out an institutional system. After that, I'll go to the government of India and say, please pass an order, pass a law saying that all temples in the hands of all state governments now are transferred to the central government, and then central government will hand it over in those in installments to the Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha, which will then either create new trustees and hand them over. So the process is on. It may take about 10 years more.
You look young enough to last.
No, not 10 years. So this is one thing that is, this process is on. And finally, do we need a new Indian constitution, which is a Hindu constitution? In my opinion, after studying this Indian constitution, present constitution, I'm convinced it's a Hindu constitution. What is there which you will put in extra? You are not going to say that Muslims can't vote and Christians can't vote. Alright. So leave that aside therefore. Ban on cow slaughter, it is there in the constitution. Yeah, Sanskrit should be brought, that's there in the constitution. In fact, says the Hindi should only use Sanskrit words. The constitution says that. What is there which is now which is part of your Hindutva demands, which is not there in the Indian constitution today? It's there, and therefore I say, please don't pursue this constitutional line. Okay. We'll have a Hindu constitution for the United States one of these days. Don't worry. No, secularism also was a word brought in by Indira Gandhi in the emergency. But secularism means nobody can be more secular than a Hindu. When we are 100%, our Parsis came here, we gave them shelter, looked after them. The Jews came here, looked after them. Even the original Christians, the Syrian Christians, we looked after them. The original Muslims who came as Arab traders, we looked after them. Is there any case of persecution on religious basis when the Hindus were in total dominant majority and in power in this country? No. So secularism is a redundant word. It's it's only a matter of time before we come around to it. But the fact is that this constitution, here and there we can make amendments, but it is a Hindu constitution. And if you see in the original constitution, there are large numbers of only Hindu leaders. The only Muslim leader whose picture is there is Akbar and nobody else, and all Sanskrit shlokas. In all the walls of parliament, you will see Sanskrit shloka. Aam nija paraveti raghu chetana aam udhana dindam vasudeva kutumbakam. So this means don't think of yours and mine. These are small matters. For us, the whole world is one family. Like that, their slogan is Dharma Charatra Parivartana. So like that, we find throughout the parliament, in walls, not only Sanskrit slogans. So therefore, I think we don't need any more. Only we need here, inside here, our Hindutva mind. And that is what this all this is about. Sorry for taking up so much time, but I thought I'd make this time.
Before conversation, request that of Swami to hand over a moment to the speaker, especially Prakash Rao Prasad. The managing director of this hotel, Mr. Prakash Rao, wanted to hand over a bouquet to Sri Subramanian Swami. So, thank you very much, Prakash Rao. We are all enjoying your hospitality in that place. See, we are actually running almost behind almost an hour. So, request the speakers of the next session to be brief because we still have Dr. Swami having to speak over the doctor construction. I request Sri Arvind Chaturvedi.